say one thing, I hear another. If you say anything, I wouldn't bother. I got this dog that follows me around. His name is Ego. His name is Ego. You sing my song, hold up a mirror. You get it wrong, couldn't be clearer. I got this fish that follows me around. His name is Oh No. His name is Oh No. Of your thoughts, I've got a bird. She's made of wood. She is a coal mine. She is a coal mine. There is a light. You cannot teach it. Put it in your middle where they cannot reach it. I got this cat that follows me around. Her name is Hell Yes. Her name is Hell.
Good evening. Welcome to our August 4th WIPP Town Hall, co-hosted by the City of Carlsbad and the Department of Energy, and being broadcast live by Red Rocket. Thank you all for joining us here today to discuss WIPP's recovery effort. I'd like to introduce some special guests we have this evening. Bernadette Granger with Congressman Pierce's office, Diane Ventura with Senator Heinrich's office, Beverly Allen with Senator Udall's office. We have Carlsbad Mayor Pro Tem Dick Doss sitting here in the back. Councilman Janelle Whitlock back here. Councilman Eddie Rodriguez. And from NMED, we have Will Teeter. And also we want to welcome Miles Hall, new attorney with DOE. Before we begin, I'd like to offer my condolences for the loss of Abe Van Loop, a Department of Energy scientist from WIPP who passed away recently. Abe attended most of these town halls and would sometimes add an explanation when it was needed. He was very well liked and respected by everyone he met, both locally in Carlsbad and internationally. He will be missed. I also want to congratulate the WIPP Blue Mine Rescue Team for winning first place in the field competition in Reno, Nevada last week. Between WIPP, Mosaic, and Intrepid Potash, we have probably the best trained mine rescue teams in the world. So again, congratulations. As everybody knows, we're holding these town halls throughout the year at points where we believe it is the right time. Right now, we're at the point in progress where it is appropriate for DOE's Casey Gadbury to talk about WIPP's changes to the National True Program and why those are being made. DOE Manager Todd Schrader is going to give us an update on WIPP progress, and NWP's Jim Blankenhorn will be talking about restart activities. As we've said many times before, the City of Carlsbad proudly supports the Waste Isolation Pilot Plant. We're committed to our workers, to a safe reopening, and to the important role we play to the nation. Now I'm going to turn things over to John Heaton, the moderator, and also thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm John Heaton, and I have the dubious honor of moderating tonight. I won't go through any more. I think the mayor explained what the agenda was tonight. It's really a very important agenda. Talking about the recovery, the status of the recovery, and also the waste acceptance criteria issued so that we can all better understand how that's now going to be managed and how it's different than how it was managed in the past. We use the same format that we've used in the past. We'll answer questions in the audience here, and then after that we will go to the online questions. I am terribly sorry, but because of the council meeting, we were unable to get the slide decks up. So it takes some time to do it, and they can't do them simultaneously with the transmission and getting them into place. So I apologize for that, but they will be online, and you'll be able to look at them at in a few days when they're on the WIPP webpage. So with that, we'll get started. Mr. Schrader, thank you.
Thank you, John. I'll start with just a follow-up a little bit of something Mayor Janway talked about, and that's Abe Van Luke. I, you know, often sat right in this area here for many of our meetings, and he will be sorely missed. But just to give you an idea of his influence, we found out the unfortunate news on a Sunday. By Monday afternoon, I was getting emails from Europe, from Asia, from Canada, all over the world, expressing condolences for the loss of Abe. And you know, he was quite influential, not just at WIPP, but also in some of our international organizations, the IAEA, et cetera. So it is an unfortunate event. The I did want to also follow up with, again, Mayor Janway mentioned we, Carlsbad Field Office, have a new attorney now, Miles Hall. We, to the detriment of DOD, stole him from White Sands over there in the Cloudcroft, Las Cruces area. So we're glad to have him. He just came on board, and so that's fills a hole we had for a little while here since our last attorney moved. So to get on with the presentation. Again, the agenda, we've talked through these. Tonight, we're going to talk a little bit about WIPP progress and some of the issues in the news. Jim's going to talk about the specific restart activities that are left. And the main portion tonight will be changes in the National True Program. And Casey's going to talk through that, those points tonight. So just a few words on where we are on progress. As we've probably seen in the news recently, we are looking hard at the schedule. A significant amount of contingency in the schedule was used earlier this year. We are still working hard, trying to get to opening in December. Right now, we're looking at all the options associated with the schedule, the contingencies needed, et cetera, looking hard at that. Frankly, if it takes a little bit more time, it takes a little bit more time. But as of now, you know, we're evaluating everything. The specific activities we have left are three readiness activities and the three sets of corrective actions after that. And because of you don't know exactly what corrective actions you'll have out of those readiness activities, it does make it a little bit difficult in scheduling. And so that's what we're trying to get our head around, to come up with the best way to estimate what we have left to go. There's also some challenges of the activities that are just off critical path or critical activities that must be done to support opening. And some of those are ground control. For instance, we have to do some additional ground control in the areas where we're going to emplace the waste, in room 5, panel 7, and some of the associated areas around there. Critical activities, not on critical path right now, but activities we have to complete, and we're working hard to do that. And we've made some improvements over the last few weeks in those areas to increase our productivity. The interim ventilation system, the next round of readiness for that begins early next week, with the hope to start it within this month in August. And then, of course, I mentioned the readiness activities and corrective actions. The other side of the house, and one we have not talked about a lot, is the National True Program. You know, WIPP itself, the operation, it's great, and opening it is a real goal for us. But frankly, it does us no good to open WIPP and not have waste coming from the other sites. That's our mission. And so the changes to the National True Program are critical to protect WIPP. They were built around the concept of we will not have a repeat of the drum exothermic event again. And we put the parts and pieces in place for that. And Casey will go into more details from there. On July 5th, we issued the new waste acceptance criteria to all the sites around the country. And because of that, they had to stop their certification activities, and they have to be recertified under new programs. Now, this was revision 8. You know, 7 other times this has happened before. This is not an unusual event every time changes have been made through the past 15 or 17 years of shipments. This happens. So right now we're working hard with the other sites to bring them back to the point of certifying waste and then eventually shipping waste here once we reopen. The couple other topics I'll just touch on very briefly. We have a settlement agreement with the state of New Mexico, and it requires us to do some supplemental environmental projects around the region for us, and then Los Alamos has some of their own up in the northern part of the state. The WIPP North Access Road, for those of you who drove out there, it was, to call it a rough road, maybe an underestimate, it was certainly in need of repair. The New Mexico Department of Transportation has come in through funding we provided and laid down a 2 or 3 inch layer of new asphalt there. It's a much better road, much better shape. Happened to drive it today, and it's much better. There's going to be some more follow-on road activities throughout the southeast New Mexico as the funding becomes available in the next fiscal year. The other part of this is we provided $1 million for various supplemental activities within the area, and this included the mine rescue teams, not just us, but some of the mines around the area, training for them, etc. And in fact, we'll talk a little bit, or Jim will talk a little bit about our mine rescue team. Particularly the blue team did well, but also the red team. They're both quite qualified and very good at what they do, and he can talk about that. He's going to talk about that a little bit. And then the last part, not a whole lot to say here, but everyone knows about the contract is earlier this year it was modified so that there's two performance option periods following the base performance period. The base performance period in September 30th of next year, 2017, at which time there's a one-year option followed by a potential four-year option after that. As of now, the department has not made any decisions on those options, and we're considering all possibilities associated with the contract moving forward. So that's basically the high level where we are on a number of these issues, and I'll turn it over to Jim Blankenhorn now to kind of go into the details of the restart activities.
Thank you, Todd. Okay, good evening. Good crowd tonight. That's great. I'm going to give you a quick update on WIPP restart activities, and let you know what we've done since the last meeting and what we still have in front of us. And then I'll save most of the time, I hope, for Casey to talk about the National True Program. So let me first start with our ongoing activities. We've talked about cold operations in the past. What this was designed to be was an 8-week period where we gave all of our crews the time to take their approved procedures and their approved processes and equipment and physically execute all of the activities and evolutions for waste emplacement. And do that in a manner where they're basically uninterrupted by folks doing audits or folks making changes to their program. So it was practice time. They've been doing that for about 8 weeks now. We are going to extend that for 2 more weeks because of some equipment issues that we had based on its availability. But the crews are doing great. They've had time to demonstrate a number of times surface waste handling. They've been working on download operations, both from the arrival of the true packs at the facility, taking the containers out, and then transitioning the containers into the underground, and then transitioning the waste from clean side of the mine to the contaminated side of the mine. And just a reminder, we'll be operating the disposal panel will be operated as a contaminated panel for probably the life of that part of the facility. And so the teams have to transition from, be able to transition the containers and themselves from a clean side to the contaminated side and then get themselves back out without cross-contaminating themselves or the equipment. So they've been working on that, and they'll continue to work that for about the next 2 weeks. Now, I do have a video that we'll show you at the end of this presentation. That gives an overview of some of that cold operations training they've been going through, and I'll show that at the end. Let me talk briefly about the readiness reviews. There, as we've talked many, many times, there are three separate readiness reviews that we've got built into our schedule. The first one is a management self-assessment, and that's scheduled to start on August 15th, so about a little over a week from now. It'll be a two-week evolution. We've got about 17 or so folks coming in. They're all external. They're from contracts around the complex. They're all subject matter experts in their areas. They're going to come in, and they'll do a performance-based examination of our facilities, of our equipment, of our procedures, and our personnel, their training and qualifications. And they're going to do an assessment of our WIPP waste and placement operations. Now, coming out of that, they'll likely identify a number of issues that we'll have to address and correct. And so we'll take some time at the end of this review to do those corrective actions. And then we'll be in a position to declare readiness for waste and placement. When we do that, that then allows us to move into the two operational readiness reviews. The first one will be a contractor operational readiness review. Again, that'll be about 15 people. It'll be all external team, contractors from around the complex. Last about 2 weeks. Once that's complete, we'll then have some corrective actions that we'll have to address. And then the Department of Energy will bring in a similar size team, about 15 to 17 folks, all independent from WIPP. Again, subject matter experts from around the complex. And they'll do a two-week evolution. And what they'll be looking at, again, it's all performance-based, so they'll be watching us perform evolutions. They'll be watching us perform waste management operations, watching us move containers, all simulated containers, not actual waste containers, but moving simulated waste containers through the facility and actually emplacing them in Panel 7. So it'll be performance-based, and again, they'll look at our procedures, they'll look at our processes, our training and quals. They'll look at the equipment and they'll look at the facilities. We will verify our readiness to commence those two readiness reviews. And those two readiness reviews are designed to do an evaluation and ensure that we're ready to operate. And then coming out of that, we'll address any pre-start items that are identified. And then the department will give us authorization to commence waste emplacement. As Todd mentioned, there's a couple of other things that aren't on our critical path, but they're ongoing issues that we have to stay on top of, and so ground control is one of those. Ground control, when we talk about ground control, what we're talking about, if you remember, it's a salt mine. The salt creeps over time. It moves. It expands. It fills the void spaces that we've mined, and so we have to constantly maintain it. We have to bar down on the ribs, on the sides, and we have to bar down on salt that comes off of the ribs. We have to redo the floors because we get salt heave that comes up and disrupts the floor surface, and we have to remine that. And then we have the back, which is constantly lowering, and we have to continuously place bolts into that back to pin it together and hold it up and hold it in place. And so ground control is an ongoing area. What we do is we've got a comprehensive system set up where every month our ground control experts, our geologists, our underground engineers collect all the data that we collect in the underground. So we've got instrumentation in the underground that monitors the salt and how fast it's moving. We've got visual inspections that get done. We've got support systems that again, we monitor and inspect. And they take all that information and they take the 20 or so years of experience that we have in the underground with our specific geology. And they determine which areas of the underground need the most attention and when. And so they set our priorities and we redo that every month. And that tells us which areas we need to go to do more bolting operations. We focus that. We've got management attention on it. Obviously, one of the things that the criteria that they use to determine where we go is they're looking at areas where we have the most access, where we have the most people in place. And if we get to a position where were unable to restore the ground control sufficiently, and we start to eat into our safety margin of safety, then we go ahead and restrict those areas, or we'll prohibit access to those areas until our ground control teams can get in and make the corrections that they need to make. So again, the bottom bullet there just describes what ground control includes. I think I mentioned all of those except as bolts break, they shear and they break off, we do have to go in on a fairly routine basis and first identify those, and then we have to remove them. So in addition to placing new bolts, we're also going out and removing old bolts that have failed over time. This is just some of the internal indicators that we use. Basically, what we wanted to do here if you'll remember, we procured about a year or so ago, we procured two hybrid bolters, and we did that because the diesel equipment that we have today obviously utilizes the available air that we have in the underground, and so we went with hybrids, which can be operated electrically. They don't generate the diesel fumes. They don't impact the air quality. So we've got those two hybrids plus three additional diesel bolters available to us, and we've been looking at different ways to optimize the use of those bolters, the use of our personnel, the most efficient crews and shifts that we can, and we've set ourselves a goal of installing about 110 bolts a week. Now that's about three times the failure rate. So about every week we get about 40 bolts throughout the mine fail, and just as a reminder, we've got about 8 to 8.5 miles in the underground, and we've got about 60,000 bolts in that area. And so about 40 of them fail a week. We're installing, as you can see from the graphs, our goal is 110. For the last several weeks, we've been far exceeding that. And what that means to all of us is that we're placing more bolts than are failing, and so we're catching up. Remember, we had a long period of time when we didn't do any bolting after the events, and we've been going in doing what we've called catch-up bolting. And so we're catching up, and you've seen graphs that we've used in the past where we've color-coded it and showed you the green areas, and we've showed you areas that still needed bolting. This is just another way of showing that data. Some of the things that we're working on to improve efficiency is we've installed a more robust maintenance program to put focus on the five bolters and make sure that we, as they go down, if they go down, we've got teams working them immediately and not taking days or weeks to get around to performing the maintenance, so we improve their operational readiness. We're looking we have already dedicated radiological support. Many of the areas where we have to do bolting are still in the contaminated areas. And so putting RADCON support dedicated to bolting so they're not pulled off on other jobs is increasing our efficiency. You know, as simple as it sounds, the teams were waiting until, like probably many of us do when we drive our cars, we wait until we get close to the E and then we find the gas station and fill up. Well, what that does in the underground is if we run the piece of equipment out of gas, it takes a while for us to mobilize the fuel truck, because again, we have to worry about air and we have to worry about where it physically is located. If it's in a contaminated area, we've got to get that into the contaminated area and back out. So it actually takes quite a bit of time to go refuel. So simple process, we just said, well, let's stop waiting until the systems run out of gas. Let's just go fill them every week at the same time, regardless of whether they need gas or not. That way we always keep them topped off and we don't have that downtime and we don't run the risk of a piece of equipment running out of fuel. And then just putting the management focus on these issues as our teams identify these types of issues to us. Hey, you know, this is what's keeping us from getting an extra hour in of bolting. The management team is putting a lot of energy in understanding those issues and then helping the team find solutions so we can get even better and more efficient with the use of our bolters. Now, all that to say, you know, we're committed to safe operations at WIPP. There's been MSHA comes out and we're working with them. They're an outstanding regulator and they really help us keep focused on safety. And bolting and ground control is a big issue with them. and obviously with us. It's obviously more difficult since the events. We have to work in a contaminated environment in some areas, but ground control is our highest priority. Even though resumption of WIPP is our overall goal, safety is our number one priority, and ground control is the number one thing that supports safety. So we've got a program to evaluate, assess, track, trend, and improve ground control, and we implement that on a daily basis. We got a robust program. We have folks that are specifically identified to go out every day and inspect the areas and identify bolts that may have issues or areas that may have issues, and they go out every day. They document that, and they feed that back into our teams to prioritize the areas. And we'll continue to do that, and we'll continue to work with MSHA and DOE to ensure that we not only maintain, but if possible, improve the safety posture. Let me switch just a minute and talk about our ventilation systems. We've talked about this a number of times in the past, but I wanted to give you a quick update. Todd mentioned it. The interim ventilation system. So we completed the contractor readiness review. We completed an external management self-assessment. We completed a CBFO line management assessment. And we're currently in the process of validating the closure of all the issues that came out of those three assessments. And the fourth and final assessment is scheduled to occur next week. So DOE will bring their team in. They'll do a readiness assessment. They'll identify issues. As they identify issues, any that we deem to be pre-starts, we'll correct those, and then we'll work with CBFO to get the approval for hot testing and hot operations. So as Todd mentioned, we expect to do that in the month of August, all pending, of course, the outcome of the DOE readiness assessment next week. That will, just as a reminder, that puts an additional 54,000 cubic feet of air into the underground. We currently have about 60, so it just about doubles the amount of air that we have in the underground. And what that allows us to do is to do more operations in the underground simultaneously. So instead of running one diesel bolter, I can run two diesel bolters at the same time. Or instead of just doing waste and placement operations, I can do waste and placement in one area of the underground, and I can do bolting in another area of the underground. So that's the significance of this. It also goes towards some of our safety concerns. More air in the underground obviously does helps us with sweeping VOCs that may accumulate in different areas. And quite frankly, just putting more air in the underground and running more air through the underground does a whole heck of a lot in terms of heat stress in the underground to keep the air moving and try to keep the area a little bit cooler. So a lot of good things come out of the interim ventilation system when we get it up and running, and we're all excited about making that happen here in the next couple of weeks. The permanent ventilation, we haven't talked much about this other than the fact that there is a permanent ventilation project. This is the line item project that you've heard us refer to in the past. And so where is it right now? As you know, we got CD1 approved not quite a year ago. And so what's happened since then is we've now contracted with a design agency, and we've contracted with folks. So the location for the new shaft and the new ventilation building has been determined. It'll be east of the existing exhaust shaft. We currently have crews, geotechnical teams in the field, and they're doing drilling. They're drilling boreholes to various depths. And the data that they're going to get from that helps them determine the bearing capacity of the soil and the geology. It helps them define the seismic picture that we'll be operating in, and it helps establish the building foundation that the facility will sit on. So all that data will be analyzed, obtained and analyzed over the next couple of weeks and months. And that feeds into the final design, which the team is working on as we speak. Now, when we do this, this is the project that will take us several years to implement. This will replace the interim ventilation that I just talked about. It will replace the existing ventilation system that we've been operating with, and it will replace the supplemental ventilation that we're going to install next year. This will be the permanent ventilation, and it'll provide a little over 500,000 cubic feet per minute. So basically back to the types of airflows that we saw prior to the events. And then I wanted to close with a safety message, if you will. You've heard the mayor talk about it, and Todd mentioned it as well. So both our teams went to the National Mine Rescue Contest in Reno, Nevada. There were 36 teams there, representing 18 states. And if a little bit more on how that's run, it's sort of like a gymnastics event for the Olympics. You have individual events, so they have a medical or a Red Cross event. They have a technical event. They have a field competition, and then the team overall gets an award. So, blue team won the most coveted of all the competitions. They won the national. They are the national champions for the field competition. We actually haven't placed first in that since, I think, 1994. Our team has been national champions a number of times. We won the overall team competitions, but we haven't been national champions for the field competition so in a long time. So an extremely impressive accomplishment for the team. The red team did equally well. They placed seventh overall out of the 36 teams. And I can tell you that the top 15 teams was extremely competitive. Just mere fractions of a point separating the teams. So anybody finishing in the top 10 was extremely notable. So we finished first and we finished seventh. Now, you know, we're obviously extremely proud of the teams, but it really goes towards the confidence and the professionalism that it gives to the rest of the WIPP team, just knowing that we've got these kinds of folks ready and available. They've got our backs if anything were to happen. And quite frankly, knowing that we've got these folks available to not just the WIPP team, but all of the mines in the area, because they respond routinely to the other mines. And the other mines similarly provide support to us when we need it. So just having this caliber of people is extremely reassuring. With that, we've got two short videos, if we can show those. Hold your ears. Last time they tested these, they blasted everybody. So that was a warning. There you go. I warned you. All right, the first video is just some video that we took last month during the cold operations. And so cold operations, as I mentioned, the team is focused on receiving true packs, as just like we would from generator sites, downloading those true packs, taking them into the waste handling building, and then taking the true packs themselves apart. So I'll let this video run, and then we've got another video on the mine safety teams. So this is a trailer, and you'll see three true packs sitting on that trailer. This is the inside of our waste handling building. What they're doing here is the routine daily checks and services on our overhead gantry cranes. This is one of those true pack twos being moved in to the unloading dock. So they've taken it off the trailer, now they've moved it into the building. And now they've got to go through a series of steps, both to loosen bolts, they've got to do inspections, they got a lot of documentation reviews to do at this point. And then they've got to, and they'll fit the adjustable center gravity lift fixture. So they'll use this to set down on top of the outer lid. And after they do some additional RADCON surveys, lift the outer lid off. So a True Pack 2 has both an outer lid and an inner lid. This is the outer lid coming off. It's about a 5,000 pound payload. And then we just set those lids over on stands. Now we've got to do some checks internally for both contamination as well as the gases inside the inner containment. So that's what the RadTech is doing now. This is the outer lid of the inner containment. And he's just swiping the internal surfaces of the outer lid. We use that same adjustable center gravity lift fixture now to set down on top of the inner lid. And once they loosen all the bolts, then they'll lift that lid off. And then they just set that down on a similar stand. So now, the second part of that video, which we will have for the next one, shows you where they take the containers out then and then take them through the conveyance, take them in the underground, transfer to the contamination area, and then place into the disposal cell. So we'll have that video next time. This is just a video of the national competition. And you'll see the WIPP blue and red teams. I think this is all about the blue team. So as I mentioned, there's a number of individual competitions. The field competition is one of them. This is the one where we're the national champions. It's a pretty robust competition. It tests the individual's knowledge. It tests their skills, their experience. And then there's a lot of simulated things that they get thrown at them while they're performing their exercise. They're moving in to retrieve somebody, but they throw a lot of things at them. They change the gas mixtures. They'll throw alarms at them, and they have to respond accordingly. They've got a surface crew that keeps tabs of everything and does all the calculations, and all that gets checked. Any misstep, somebody doing something out of order, a wrong calculation, and those are points coming off their score. These are the surface crews that are doing all the calculations for them. They're monitoring their time, their oxygen consumption. They're also monitoring all the conditions in the underground. They're happy because they know they nailed it. They don't know their score yet, but they know they nailed it. Another one of the competitions is a first aid competition. Our red team did the best on this. They finished sixth out of the 36 teams on the first aid competition. And then again, they get tested on their technical skills. So all that equipment that they have to use and they have to take with them, they've got to know how to operate it. They've got to know how to check it. They've got to know how to repair it. They've got to know how it works. They've got to explain the science behind it and all the engineering features. And again, everything they get wrong, without references, everything they get wrong is just a point off of it. All the teams get together. This is one of the other teams that we actually help mentor. It's actually catching up with us, which is a good thing. The WIPP teams have set the standard across the nation. Every other mine rescue team benchmarks themselves against the WIPP team, and quite frankly, every one of them is gunning for us. They all pride themselves on how well they did against the WIPP team. So. And we got to work hard to maintain our position. A lot of good teams out there, but the reason they're so good is because their WIPP has set the standard and they're all chasing us. So we've done a lot, not just here locally, but nationwide. And as you can see, they bring quite a bit of bling home with them after they go and win a lot of this stuff. About every time we send him off to a competition, we got to build him a new trophy case. Okay, with that, you can go back to the slides. Casey.
All right, well, thanks for that, Jim. Yeah, that was a great demonstration of the capabilities that we have here, and I'm very proud to be a part of it. I also want to say just a quick word. Abe Van Luke, I was his supervisor, and wonderful individual. I'm going to greatly miss him. So, all right, we can go ahead to the next slide. I guess I got control, right? All righty. Okay, so changes to the National TRU program. I think this is the first time we've introduced this topic at the town hall, at least in its name, National TRU program. Pretty much we focus on our local asset here with the WIPP site. So to first kind of explain what is the National TRU program, you start with what is our overall mission? Well, it's basically three pieces. We're responsible to characterize and certify that the waste will meet both transportation and disposal requirements at the WIPP site. So out of those three pieces, we've been focusing on the town halls at the very bottom square, which is everything that needs to be done at WIPP to safely dispose of the waste. Well, what we're going to talk about tonight is the National TRU program. So it's the other two pieces, to characterize the waste and certify it at the generator sites, the sites that generate the waste, then transport it through the transportation routes that you can see there. And specifically, when we talk about the changes that we're going to make in the National TRU program in order to prevent recurrence of an event such as what occurred February 2014 at the WIPP site, it will be in the area of characterization and certification. That's what this presentation's focused on. So I'm gonna kinda go through it carefully. I know it's kind of a little, you know, oblique in terms of, you know, it's not as concrete as you have a facility that you look at with a WIPP site. It's a lot of moving pieces and parts. And so I'll kinda show it graphically. So when you look at the National TRU program, and this is just kind of a simple graphic representation, if you look at that center triangle, what is the National TRU program? And you hear different entities saying, well, this organization is or that organization is. Actually, it's a conglomeration of several organizations working together. So the National TRU program actually is managed by the Carlsbad Field Office, but also has certified programs and the generator sites as represented by the other triangles. So the Carlsbad Field Office, we manage the National TRU program. What that includes is we have to do a full TRU waste inventory, all of the TRU waste that's out there and available to come to the WIPP site. We have to ensure that it's packaged correctly, characterize, we're gonna go into more details in terms of what is characterization, certify that it's going to meet the requirements to be safely transported and disposed at the WIPP facility, the transportation itself, and then various technical support and the regulatory interface. We have three key regulators in the National TRU program, the New Mexico Environment Department, which contains in the hazardous waste facility permit, contains the waste analysis plan, that has all the requirements that describe how you're supposed to characterize and certify the waste. And then the Environmental Protection Agency, who's responsible for regulating the radiological constituents of the waste, as well as the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, who's responsible for regulation of the packages that we use to transport the shipments down the road. The next triangle on the green are what we call WIPP certified programs. So I think a lot of folks are familiar with the term CCP or the Central Characterization Program. It's actually a program or an department that's part of the WIPP M&O contractor, Nuclear Waste Partnership, and it is certified by the Carlsbad Field Office to ensure that the sites have properly prepared the waste for shipment to WIPP. A key piece of that, and we're going to get into more details, of that characterization, and it's really the starting point and the central point and the final point in terms of making sure that we have adequately characterized that waste. And it is a collection of all the documentation of the history of what generated that waste. You know, we have some waste, and we have disposed of waste that was generated, you know, back in the 40s and 50s, 60s, 70s, all throughout. We have to make sure we have an accurate record of what occurred with that waste, and if it has to be repackaged or treated, what was done in order to do that. We also have to do non-destructive examination, and we'll get into that a little bit. You can do that in two different ways or a combination of the two ways. You can actually do an X-ray or real-time radiography of the containers. You have to make sure you discern all the discernible items in the waste. Or you can do visual examination, which is actually workers at the site that have to suit up in protective clothing and respirators, open up the containers and visually make sure they can identify all the contents. Obviously, we prefer trying to utilize the real-time radiography because it doesn't expose the workers to the hazards. And then we have the radiological characterization that meets the EPA requirements, and then a flammable gas analysis and the headspace gas frame of the drum to meet transportation requirement. And all of that data is then input into our waste data system, which has a lot of checks and controls to ensure that it meets all those requirements. Then the third triangle is what's actually done at the site and what they're responsible for. So the site or the generator site or the true waste site, as we call them, they have to follow the waste acceptance criteria. Todd introduced that topic earlier in the presentation, and I'm going to get into that a little more. It contains all the limits and the requirements that are listed, and you must follow the transportation requirements. Waste is verified by CCP or Advanced Mixed Waste. Now, I did talk about the certified programs, and in the green triangle you see CCP and AMWTP. So in the case of programs that have been certified by the Carlsbad Field Office to characterize and certify waste, there's two organizations that do that. There's CCP, who works for a Nuclear Waste Partnership, but they are certified at every site that they are at. And right now, we have the main sites, you know, Savannah River site down in Aiken, South Carolina. We have Idaho National Lab up in Idaho Falls, Idaho. We have Los Alamos National Lab in Los Alamos, New Mexico. We have Oak Ridge National Lab in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. Hanford, CCP operates up there. They're certified up there as well. The AMWTP is another organization. It's the contractor that runs the Advanced Mixed Waste Treatment Project, which operates a supercompactor at the Idaho National Lab. And so those two entities are the only two organizations that are certified to characterize and certify waste. But CCP is pretty much certified at every site, and Advanced Mixed Waste is only certified at Idaho. So a little bit more on the characterization processes so that they can certify that the waste meets the requirements. So under that umbrella of what's in the WIPP certified program and what do we check for, as I said before, the first step is the acceptable knowledge documentation. We put in red there, including chemical compatibility evaluations. That's actually one of the enhancements, and we're going to go into a little more details on what is a chemical compatibility evaluation, and why are we now doing it, and why do we now believe that it's building confidence in preventing the recurrence of the events. The next steps are basically the other characterization methods that pretty much confirm what we know about the waste from the acceptable knowledge documentation. So the first step there, the visual confirmation of each waste container compared to the real-time radiography or visual examination methods. So that's a picture of the real-time radiography or the X-ray. The next is radiological characterization. It's basically radiological instrumentation that determine if it meets the requirements to be transuranic waste. Does it contain transuranics? Does it have them at the certain quantities so that they meet the requirements to be disposed at WIPP? And then, as you can see on that fourth picture, the flammable gas analysis. So he's actually taking a sample of the gas in the headspace and then making sure it's within the limits to transport it on the road. And then all that data goes into the WIPP waste data system, as I said before. That, in a nutshell, is what the WIPP certified program does on authorization from Todd, the Carlsbad Field Office Manager. So a little bit more in terms of the interrelationships in the National TRU program. So the Carlsbad Field Office is responsible, and this is what was done even before the events occurred, is that the quality assurance, the Office of Quality Assurance from the Carlsbad Field Office conducts certification audits. It has to conduct an initial certification audit in order to certify that site to characterize and certify waste. One thing that's not up there is, in addition to that Office of Quality Assurance, the representatives of the National TRU program in the Carlsbad Field Office also have some oversight responsibilities in that audit as well. The other interface or oversight that is occurring is that the certified program, represented by CCP or AMWTP, does oversight and interface with that generator site. And that's really the key component of acceptable knowledge, or the AK, is that as the site is handing the certified program the containers of waste, then the certified program is ensuring that they have all the appropriate information, including all the procedures that the site conducted to put the waste in the drums, if they had to repackage them or treat them. All of that information is obtained, that's represented through the green arrow. So what went wrong in terms of the National TRU program? Well, I have a copy of the cover of the accident investigation report, phase two, from the radiological event. You can find it on the WIPP homepage. And in it, it's a very large document, but I basically kind of boiled it down to, when I analyzed the actual causes of the events, there were several root causes, and a root cause is the cause that if you were to address that, it would prevent the event from occurring again. And then there was a series of 12 contributing causes that contributed or set up the tone, if you will, to allow those root causes and the direct causes to occur. So as I analyzed those, I basically came up with, there's three basic types of failures that occurred in those causes. First, you have your implementation failure. And what that consists of is, we have procedures, we have processes that personnel are supposed to follow. Step by step, this is what you need to do. And those are specified in those procedures. There were obviously failures in implementation, because what we ended up with from the waste in Los Alamos is that incompatible chemicals were mixed, nitrate salts and organic absorbents. The implementation corrective actions are going to be your quickest method to address those failures. If you can fix those, the step-by-step processes, then that's what basically you have good assurance that that problem, that specific problem, won't occur again. Now, the next type of failure that we saw from the causes are management failures. So those are failures of management or supervision to make sure they support and guide the employees that they're following the processes and the procedures, and that they report conditions that are unanticipated, which represents a poor safety culture at the site. And as you read the report, you can see that there were things that were occurring as they were mixing the incompatible materials that weren't reported, or they didn't know what to report. And so those corrective actions to address those issues, those are going to provide the long-term system culture change and the infrastructure that's needed that will give the employees the assurance that as long as they have those systems in place, they have confidence that they're performing appropriately. And then the third type of failures that we saw in the causes were oversight failures. So in addition to the actual workers performing the procedures and processes and the management ensuring that the processes are in place, then we have a series of oversight that's required to be conducted both from the local perspective, from our office, and also from headquarters. And there were a number of failures that occurred in that in terms of adequate monitoring and providing that feedback to those workers and the management team of the contractors and the national lab participants. So what it does is it ensures safe and compliant performance. And when you lack those constant assessments to ensure the process was being correctly followed, then it can set up basically a system that could allow these other failures to occur. So the corrective actions to correct those will provide the continuous monitoring and feedback that's needed to keep sustaining this in the long run. So what does that mean in terms of our model that we discussed earlier? So first of all, we have a new qualification program for our folks in the National TRUE program that provide oversight at those sites. So we've added that they understand better, and they will be qualified to say, when you are providing this oversight, these are the things you need to look for. What existed before, we talked about in the certified program where it says CCP, is that gathering of the acceptable knowledge for the waste. What we did is we enhanced that. I'm going to go into a few steps of what we did to help enhance and improve that, which also included a basis of knowledge testing, which I'll talk about further as well. The generator sites, they had procedures. They were packaging, they were treating to procedures. But now what we have is more procedure controls to ensure that we get better characterization of the waste before we receive it and allow it to ship to WIPP. And then also there's going to be more rigorous reviews that will be conducted of the site. And now required walkdowns, not just interviews with the generator site, but actually walking down the processes to verify what are the materials that you're mixing with the waste. How are you doing this? You know, what's the performance of your work as you're doing this to see if there's any indicators that we need to look into further. One additional review is represented by the arrow that goes from the Carlsbad field office to the site. Is the generator site technical reviews. I'll talk about that a little bit further as well, but that's an example of the additional reviews we're going to do. And then also, we recently did another restructuring of the Carlsbad field office to clarify the roles and responsibilities of the National TRUE program, those that are implementing it. In the report, there were documentation of where maybe it was unclear what people's roles and responsibilities were in terms of providing oversight from the Carlsbad field office to those generator sites. This restructuring is going to help clarify what those are. Now, I know this is a very busy schedule. I think what it's meant to represent was a lot the additional levels and layers that we're putting on to help provide the assurance that the events like this don't occur again. And then we have the new waste acceptance criteria, which we introduced earlier. I'm going to talk a little bit more about here in a little bit. All right, so let's get into a little bit of the details. So in terms of improved implementation, acceptable knowledge, we talked about that, documentation. What are we enhancing to that? Well, we're doing a new method that's called chemical compatibility evaluations. It's actually a specific method prescribed by the Environmental Protection Agency. And what it does is it starts with the gathering of all the chemicals and materials that we know are in the waste. As I said before, one of the key components is the inventory. We have to inventory all the waste. And so we research and we identify all the chemicals and the materials. Then we have to identify, are there any incompatibilities? And I've got a chart here on the next slide that kind of shows the method how we do that. In addition to that, we actually have a new basis of knowledge report or testing that's coming out that's going to help us better understand the oxidizing chemicals. Well, what does that mean, oxidizing chemicals? Well, our New Mexico Environment Department permit requires that we do not, we are prohibited from disposing of wastes that are ignitable, that are corrosive, or are reactive. Well, one component of ignitability are oxidizers, and that was the key chemical that caused the reaction of the energetic drum and the WIPP. So we're actually conducting testing that's going to mix the fastest burning oxidizers with the fastest burning absorbers so that we better understand those reactions, and then we can get to some proposed resolutions so that if those quantities are identified, then we can give them the recipe for this is how you need to treat this. So the chemical compatibility evaluation, what is it? As I described earlier, it's basically as represented by this chart. So you can see, I don't know how well you can see that, but up on the left-hand side, it has a lot of different types of groups in terms of chemicals. They're called reactivity group names. Some of the things that are called out is alcohols and glycols, ethers, ketones, hydrocarbons, so you can go down the list. And you can see it has a number, so that on the horizontal axis there, it also has a number. So when you compare the one number to the other, you come to the junction, and then you'll see little letters that are placed in there. And up on the upper right-hand corner there, it shows what the letters mean. So in some instances, when you mix some of these chemicals or materials together, you can have heat generation, fire, flammable gas generation, toxic gas generation, explosion, violent polymerization, things such as that. What that does is that just identifies what those potentials are. Then the acceptable knowledge expert has to then go and gather research and information to determine what quantities do these exist, and does that actual hazard, is it really represented, or is it in minimal quantities, or has it been processed in a way that chemical is no longer there? But they have to go and prove that's what's occurred in there. And if they cannot do that, then there has to be a prescription as to how are you going to treat that waste. And so that specific waste then is kicked out of the waste stream and then has to be resolved before going through. Other things that improve implementation is we have new process for procedures at the generator sites. So as I said before, the generator sites have procedures to do their packaging and treatment. And before, what occurred in the event, if you read the report, is that there wasn't really good controls in terms of the changes made to the procedures. I think you probably read in there where it talked about mix up of, was this a minor change? Was it a major change? Did the folks that are collecting the acceptable knowledge, did they need to look at that? Did they need to go look at the process? There was a lot of confusion there. Now there is a requirement in the waste acceptance criteria that requires that every procedure change is identified in a list and verified to make sure that the processes comply, will end up in an end state with waste that complies with the requirements when we try to characterize and certify it. And then lastly, what's identified is that it says re-verify previously certified waste. So from the time of the events, we have continued to certify waste under the previous program. And so we knew that we had to ensure that we had a check that went back and verified that waste is going to meet all of the new requirements. And so what we do on a container basis level is we conduct a one-time assessment that looks at every container in that waste stream and says, have we done all the additional checks we needed to do on that so that it meets the new requirements in the new waste acceptance criteria that we have. As far as oversight, we have new headquarters oversight programs. Actually, Todd, or I talked about the restructuring in CBFO, that's the next bullet, but a couple of weeks ago, headquarters restructured as well, and they actually generated a brand new office that is specifically provides oversight of the National True Program now. So we'll be held accountable specifically to their oversight programs as well. Also, we restructured to clarify and focus our roles and responsibilities. What a lot of that was about was that in our previous oversight, there was basically dual roles. We were providing oversight of both, are you complying with the requirements, and are you within your cost scope and schedule? A lot of what we've done in the restructuring is segregate those two so that we've got people specifically focused on, are you meeting the requirements, and other folks focused on the cost scope schedule. Obviously, the two entities have to work together so that we get the finished product that we need. But now we have folks specifically focused, and they're not potentially put in the situation where, you know, oh, I have this schedule versus this requirement. No, you're focusing on the requirements. Leave the cost scope schedule to these other entities to work with. As I said before, we have a new qualification program for the oversight of the National True Program, and those individuals, actually, we have increased the time that they spend at those TrueWay sites to make sure that those requirements are met. The generator sites must be recertified, and we're going to talk about that in terms of implementation of the waste acceptance criteria. And we have the new generator site technical reviews. And actually, in our representation, we showed that it was the Carlsbad Field Office conducting the review of the sites. But actually what it is it's going to be a partnership between the Carlsbad Field Office and the M&O contractor, or Nuclear Waste Partnership. We're both on the assessment team. And what we represent at those reviews is both the owner and the operator of WIPP. So that when we're going to the generator sites, the folks that are responsible for the consequences of what happens at WIPP now has to hold accountable those generator sites to making sure that their programs are intact. Do they have solid conduct of operations programs where their people are following procedures? And then specifically when they interface with our certified programs to make sure they get the data that they need that they can adequately certify the program. That's what the heart of those generator site technical reviews are. We've never done those before. This is going to be a new look. And I think this is going to be a great enhancement to ensuring and giving confidence to those who are operating the WIPP that they've got good quality waste that's coming to the site. So the new waste acceptance criteria, we talked about that. It was revision 8. It was issued June 27th. We made it effective a couple weeks later, so people had an opportunity, the generator sites had an opportunity to wind down their programs and then suspend their certification of their waste. It incorporates the requirements of our new WIPP documented safety analysis. There was actually a brand new chapter that was added to that documented safety analysis, or the safety base, chapter 18, and that's specific to the WIPP waste acceptance criteria compliance. The generator sites are temporarily suspended, as Todd said, for certifying their waste, and they have to complete a recertification audit before they can certify the new waste. And they also have to complete a generator site technical review in order to ship. Now, when I say complete a review, it's not that we just do the review and we go away and say you're done. Both the certification audit and the review, a series of corrective actions or a series of issues will be identified. They have to complete all the corrective actions before we can certify them. So the bottom line is that the improvements in the National True Program, they're based upon the causes that were identified in the accident investigation report. That's what gives me the confidence that the events will not occur again. We've added new and additional oversight. We have a new waste acceptance criteria that comes from the safety basis at the WIPP site. We have the new basis of knowledge that's going to identify more information in terms of the oxidizing chemicals that are in the waste and what potential incompatibilities you could have and how you remedy that. And then we have new processes for certifying the waste and approving those certification programs that look upstream to see what the generator sites are doing. And then lastly, once again, we have to recertify every site before they're allowed to certify waste again and ship. So now I will open it up for questions and answers. And that's for anyone, whether it's me or these guys.
Thank you.
You've had a lot of information and a lot of information. And so we'd like to open it up for questions. Let me say something just briefly before we get started on that. You know, there's a lot of pride in this community about WIPP, and it's been a focus of pride for, it's very unique, and we feel like we're doing a national service with this program. But, you know, the folks that do the work, they now have a whole new series of standards that they have to know, that they have to live by, safety and process, and then they have to demonstrate. When they talk about performance-based activities, they have to demonstrate that they can do these things. It's not just the didactic reviews or understanding, it's actually doing them. And so, you know, it's a whole new performance standard that exists at the site. And all of us in this room know a lot of people that work at WIPP, not just the people that are out here leading it. It's the people down in the trench that are really doing the job. And I think that all of you that know those people and see those people on a routine basis, you ought to thank them for the work they're doing and the effort they're putting into it and the reestablishment of the pride that we all have in WIPP. So I think if you all would really take that to heart, because these people are working hard. It's difficult. It's difficult to change all of the basis for how you've been performing in the past. And it's a whole different culture, and they need encouragement. And we all want to reestablish the same pride we've always had in WIPP, and I think we're going to do that. So anyway, if you'll do that with that, I'm sorry to make that remark. But at any rate, if we could answer any questions that any of you have about the process, the progress that's being made, the systems, and then this new CCP WAC program, the waste acceptance criteria. Would be happy to try to answer those. If no questions, Sophie, thank you for being here.
I don't have a question, but I would like to make a comment. I think Doubtful was the one that put something in the chemical and engineering news and thought, well, why can't we do this in Carlsbad? And he knew to go ahead with the legislative and grant it. We realize that the representatives are the ones.
Mr. McGuff was right in there, right from the beginning. So thank you. And he had his wife, Sophie, pushing him all the way. And Sophie's made a tremendous contribution to the community in the education arena. So we thank the McGuff family tremendously. You've been great assets and still are. So any other questions? Mary, I would be disappointed with that.
Now, we've had, have we had any other canisters come to WIPP that have been improperly packaged? Because I've never heard of that. All I've heard is this one.
No, actually, we have. If you, I don't know if you recall watching the news, but historically, we've had some instances where we actually had to turn containers away. We returned them back to their generator site so that they could be properly characterized. We reported it to the regulators. I think in some instances we received compliance orders. In some instances we had containers we actually that were in place several rows back, and we had to go in and we had to move those waste rows out, go retrieve the one container, and then return it back to the in one instance it was Idaho, another instance it was Los Alamos. So we actually have had a very robust program. And that's why I also focused on a number of the issues related to implementation. The program was there. We did have the checks and balances. There were just enough of the failures that occurred that resulted in the energetic drum in the underground. But historically, we've had a pretty robust program, and we've been able to turn away some of the containers. Oh yeah, 11,000 shipments or so. We've done return shipments, I think, three times. So out of all those 11,000 shipments, three shipments back. And then they corrected them and sent them back to us, properly characterized and certified.
And the reason we didn't catch this one was because Lanel had not properly said what was in the canister. Basically.
Yeah, that's correct. I mean, you read the report, and as I said, it's not that simple, right? There was a series of failures that occurred, but that was the direct cause, that they mixed incompatible materials. But had we had some of the other controls or implemented certain things in place, we may have prevented it. So, but it just goes to the robustness of the program and the diligence that folks have to look at this and make sure. And I'll tell you, just talking to the people that are involved with that, they're going to ensure that we'll have a much better program now.
Okay, back when the environmental studies were made in preparation for WIPP, they made predictions on temperature rise in the deposited materials. You've got enough deposit collected now. Are you seeing temperature rises yet?
No, I don't know of any, Jim. No, we're not seeing the temperature rise that was predicted. As a matter of fact, in a lot of the vulnerability reports that was done early on, we're well under what was expected in terms of, you know, any kind of event or accident.
Radiolysis, hydrogen production, all of those are negligible that were considered in the early days. Anybody else? Yes, Maddie.
I was just wondering, when you were talking about, you know, the bolting and how you have to kind of cordon off areas sometimes, how do you ensure the safety of the workers that have to go into the cordoned areas to, like, fix it?
Yeah, a little bit more information on the bolting strategy that we've executed over the years. There's a term that we use called overbolting, and what that means is we don't just go in and say, it requires five bolts in this area to have a conservative factor of one. We actually go in and bolt to a level where we have four times what we need. So when we start to see bolts fail, what that allows us, it gives us a buffer. We might reduce it to a level of two or a level of three, but we're not below one, which is, you know, which would start to get you into a dangerous situation. So as that margin of safety degrades, we simply restrict access so that people that are just doing routine activities aren't in that area. And then we send our ground control crews in, and they'll do a full evaluation of the conditions first, but then they'll go right in and they'll reestablish that bolting pattern and reestablish that minimum of a four-time safety posture. So we never get the guys into a situation where they're actually at risk of a roof fall. No, not at all. And it's just because of the amount of work that the team did prior to the events. They did so much over-bolting that we've got a large margin of safety in our areas. Does that answer the question?
Simple question. How do you tell when a bolt has failed?
Yeah, I should have, we didn't have any pictures this time. It's actually pretty easy to see. What happens is the bolt gets, most of the bolts are threaded and they have an epoxy material that goes up into the hole and seals the bolt. The bolts can range from 10 feet to 16 feet long. And what happens is when the salt layers shift, it shears the bolt. And what happens to the bolt itself then is it pops. It doesn't come all the way out, but it generally moves a foot or two. We've got steel lanyards that we attach to them so that as they do, it catches the bolt so it doesn't fall on anybody. But now you can physically go back in and you can see where the bolt itself has come down a foot or 2 feet, and it's caught by its lanyard. So it's a visual indicator. We can go in and physically see them. Now that's not 100% of the case, but when a bolt shears, eventually it will start to work its way out.
This way.
It shears this way and then and basically snaps, causes the bolt itself to snap.
Plate itself come off.
The plate that holds it, you'll see it, it'll pull through the plate itself. So there are, it's all visual indicators.
How big are these drums? I'm thinking of the size of the bullet, but obviously it must be much larger.
Yeah, so there's different types of containers. The one type of container that we have the most of is your standard 55-gallon drum. That's the size that it is. We also have standard waste boxes that are a larger box where you could overpack four of those 55-gallon drums. We have even a larger container that fits, it pretty much lines the inside of the true pack, that you could fit 10 drums. We call it the 10-drum overpack. We also have a standard large box that fits inside of a true pack 3, and that's actually like a large box, as it states, 5 foot by 5 foot by 8 foot. So that way at the sites, they could put larger items. One of the things that we wanted to provide the capability to the sites is, just imagine they have some large components and they're radioactively contaminated. But in order to get them into the packages, they may have to cut them up. Well, the more that you have to use like metal saws and things like that, puncture, you could get punctures, you could get cuts, and it could inject radioactive contamination in the body. So we provided these larger containers so that they wouldn't have to resize some of these things. So we have a vast number of types of containers, but number one by large of what we have down are the 55-gallon drums that you think of when you think of an oil drum. That answer the question?
Let's try to catch some questions online here.
Good evening. Just to let everybody in the audience know, we've had about 20 people participating online today. First question, the DNFSB reported that in late May 23rd, a roof bolt base plate fell in a frequently occupied area. What location, what subsequent similar events or roof falls?
Yeah, so the question was about a roof bolt. So again, let me describe, go back to the question earlier, just describe the bolting again. So when we take a bolt and we install it into a drilled hole in the roof, we then put a plate, which is approximately 8 inches square, on the bottom of that bolt against the ceiling or against the back, and then we put a bolt on, a nut on it. And then we attach the lanyard to either the roof or to a chain link fence so that when it fails we can see that. So as I mentioned, most of the time when a bolt fails, it gets sheared and it drops and we see the hanging bolt or the end of the bolt hanging. Sometimes it will pull the bolt the other way. It will pull the bolt physically up into the ceiling and it'll pull through. That nut will pull through the plate and the plate itself then can fall. And so I think it was in May, we had a plate that fell in our lunchroom area near where some of our rad techs were working. And I think in this particular case, it damaged a piece of RadCon equipment. I'm not gonna say it's an unusual event. It happens several times a year. Now we usually, what we try to do is, it doesn't happen right away. Usually what you can see over a period of weeks and months is you can see the bolt start to pull up, and you can see the plate itself start to deform. And so we try to pay attention when we're doing our inspection. Remember, there's 60,000 of them we're checking. But we do try to pay attention, and we look at the plates, and if we see them starting to deform, then we'll go ahead and treat that as a failed bolt, and we'll try to take care of that before it fails totally.
Continue. Next question. The WIPP integrated baseline you released in February shows 72 days of margin on the restart. How many days of margin have you used as of today?
Yeah. A significant portion of that was used in the development DSA. And as we've talked about before, the schedule's now very tight with the remaining margin. And that's why we're looking at the critical path analysis at this point moving forward.
Do you want me to continue, Ms.? Okay. Third question, and this was asked during, I believe, around one of the videos or prior to that. Why are the newly accepted containers being transitioned from the clean side to the dirty side? Start clean, stay clean. Isn't that the motto?
It actually has to do with the area in which we'll dispose of the waste drums is in panel 7. Panel 7 is where the event occurred, and so that entire area is contaminated. Obviously, ground underground is very valuable. It takes a long time to mine, and so we are going to use that area moving forward. Eventually, when panel 7 gets full and we move to panel 8, which is not contaminated, we'll change our procedures and our processes moving forward.
Thank you. Continue. Fourth question. Let me do one more on the one since who will perform the DOE verification of AK and CCEM? Who in DOE will sign for them?
So it's the Carlsbad Field Office. In our restructuring, as I talked about earlier, I didn't go into the details, but basically we separated it into two primary offices. Now we'll have the Office of the National True Program and then the Office of WIPP. In the new Office of the National True Program, there will be two divisions. As I talked about before, there's that segregation of focus. So we'll have a division that focuses on compliance requirements and a division that focuses on operations, cost, scope, schedule. It's in the division of the compliance of NTP requirements that those individuals will have to review and approve those documents for authorization by the new assistant manager for the Office of National True Program that will happen. So it's basically within the office. Now, in addition to that, the Carlsbad Field Office assigns reviewers from the Los Alamos National Lab Carlsbad office here. As you know, there's a number of scientists and chemists. They're very familiar with the waste. That's what their expertise is. And then also our technical assistance contractor has some experts as well. So it's basically a body of people that do the reviews, have to get their comments resolved before the approval occurs. So it's a very rigorous approval process.
I was interested in knowing your capacity. How long do you think that you have room to continue operating?
Well, the Land Withdrawal Act gave us authorization to dispose of 6.2 million cubic feet of waste. And so we are in the process of doing that. As we've done the inventories across the complex of the waste that's out there that needs to become to WIPP, our current projection is that we have enough waste to take us through the year 2050. 50. Yeah. We've passed 2015, so yeah, it has to be 2050.
that date was increased, I think it was last year. Prior to that, it was a 2030 date.
Right.
And recognizing the volume of food waste out in the complex that needs to be put away, that was extended.
Is there any other site in the country that also accepts this strategy?
No. There is no other site that's authorized to dispose of defense-generated transuranic waste.
Thank you.
This is the only licensed repository for nuclear materials in the world.
Mr. Heaton, I have three more online questions. Do you want me to? Parenthetically, which items are today on your critical path to resumption of waste emplacement, or which items were last on the critical path when you last assessed the critical path?
The critical path items are the same that we've had before, and we mentioned these before. It's the three readiness activities, the management self-assessment, the contractor ORR, the Department of Energy ORR, and the performance of corrective actions from those. So those six elements, and we're in the middle of the seventh, which is perform cold ops.
Thank you. Two more. Roughly how much bolting is now done en masse with anti-seize? And if somebody could explain that question to.
Yeah, so the question, I believe, what they're referring to when they say anti-seize is the PPE that we wear. It's the anti-contamination. So they're wearing booties, they're wearing gloves, they're wearing a PAP or a respirator, and then they've got protective overgarments on. So the question is how much bolting is being done basically in a contaminated area. Most of the bolting that we have left to do is in the contaminated area. We've recovered most of the clean side, has been bolting has been restored in most of those areas. Now, an exception is panel 8, which, as Todd mentioned, is a clean area. That still has bolting remaining, but most of the remaining bolting is in the contaminated side of the facility.
Thank you. And my last online question for the evening: Jim Blankenhorn said the IVS lets you run one versus two diesel bolters, or run a bolter and do waste emplacement. At the Waste Management Conference in Phoenix, NWP said IVS allows one or the other. What changed?
Yeah, I'm not sure I said that, but all I was trying to do was give an example of today we have 60,000 CFM in the underground. And we can operate two or three pieces of diesel equipment before we utilize that air quality in the underground. All I was trying to say was, so today I'm limited to the number of pieces of equipment I can operate simultaneously. When we get IVS in place, we essentially are able to double the amount of equipment that we're operating. So again, I think what I said in Phoenix was that when we start operations, given the limited air capacity that we have, we may run in campaigns where I dedicate all of the underground to a certain number of shifts, where we simply work on ground control, or we work on maintenance evolutions, and then we would dedicate other shifts fully to waste emplacement. Now, that's simply an operational efficiency issue. All I was trying to indicate was that when we get IVS, we have increased air capacity, and that allows us to operate more pieces of equipment at the same time in different areas of the underground, and we could do different operations simultaneously as well.
Any other questions? You know, sometimes we forget WIPP is much more complicated than just a repository. It's a mine that has all of its safety issues associated with mining, and then at the same time we had all the radiologic considerations for safety that have to be included as well, and so it makes it that much more complicated. And I think we sometimes forget about that, but it requires both to be commingled, if you will, at the same time in order for it to be a very safe place for the workers and for the community and for everyone. So that makes it a little more complicated. So any other questions? If not, thank all of you that are online, and most especially thank you for being here this evening. And we hope you have a nice rest of the evening, and meditate about WIPP, and thank the workers. Please thank the workers for their efforts. When you see them or talk to them, I think it's really important that they know that the community's behind them and that they're working hard. And there's a lot of detail to what they're doing now. This is like being an airline pilot to anymore. You know, you fly the plane for a while, and then you go into a simulator. You fly the plane, you go into a simulator. This is kind of the same kind of operation now. It's a big change. And so I think that there, it's having to learn the procedures, the details, the safety, and then actually do them and show that you can do them is a big change. So they're doing a great job, so thank them. Thank you for being here.
Song, hold up a mirror, you get it wrong, couldn't be clearer. I got this fish that follows me around, his name is Oh No, his name is Oh No. And the colors in the sky are bright. Alright, alright, grab the gun, it's in the glove box. You can't outrun the pace of your thoughts. I've got a bird, she's made of wood. She is a coal mine, she is a coal mine. There is a light, you cannot teach it. Put it in your middle, where they cannot